Greetings, dear friends. We welcome you to another Church in the Home. We hope we're right there with you in your home or wherever you are. Many of you are in buildings and church buildings and other places like Sunday school rooms, and I don't know where all you may be meeting, but there are people around the world who will be receiving this message today, and we're coming to you from Dallas, Texas, right out of my home, and a group of people are gathered with us here. And we'd like to feel linked together with every one of you that found Christ as your life. Every one of you that's had Christ revealed in you as your life. We want to be linked to you. We want to be a part of you. And we want to be with you through all thick and thin, good and bad. We know that this is a perilous journey we're on right now. And many times you may stand alone, but he that's in you is bigger than anything that's against you. He is your life. You cannot lose that life. It is eternal life. Always will be. And so we encourage you today in the Lord to keep the message flowing, keep the gospel going out, and have somebody new to join with you next time we come to you with Church in the Home. It is a great joy to know that Christ lives in us and that Christ is working through us. And today I want to have a good message for you right from my dear wife. She's going to say a word for you, and then I'm going to get into the Word. And just before I go into the Word, we're going to have a song, a blessed song from Paul Friesen. I know he'll bless your heart. He's in our Tulsa Fellowship, and he loves to sing. And I want you to listen to all that goes on today, for God has something special for you. Okay, Robbie, if you will.
Well, it's good to be with you today. Sure enjoyed the hymns this morning. I was raised on hymns, and we sang a few choruses in the churches that I grew up in, but we always sang the hymns, and I really have missed the hymns, and so it was really nice this morning to sing the hymns. I've been reading a book about a couple of missionaries who were in the China Inland Missions organization deep into China, and my heart has really been stirred after reading this book. I had read it once before, and I was searching something out, and went to this book and got caught up in it again. And the point I want to share with you today, when their cupboards were bare, when they almost froze to death, when they had nothing to keep them warm, they were singing the hymns by memory, hymns that they had sang growing up in church as little children at their parents' knees, and the words in the song in the hymns are in this book, and some of them I had never heard, but the meat of the scriptures in these hymns, and even their children were singing the hymns when they didn't have anything at their table to eat, and how the Father brought food and brought warmth from the inner source. And they talk about this secret source they had where Christ in them warmed them, and Christ in them kept them full when they had nothing to eat. But the thing that stuck out to me was the presence and the strength and the encouragement that the hymns brought to them. And I thought then I'd really like for my grandchildren to know the hymns and my children, because you know, mom and dad's not going to always be there, and they may not always have you, but it's just wonderful to have the message that are in these hymns. So that just touched my heart this morning. I want to talk to you about another missionary. If a missionary came to your door, and this missionary had just been on a long, hard trip, the beginning of this missionary was hard. The preparations, the financial dependence, seeking finances for the journey, all the preparations. And this missionary arrived at your door, knocked on your door, and you opened your door up and took this missionary in. And then you sat this missionary on a chair, and then you went about your business and left that missionary sitting there. You ignored this missionary. You glanced at this missionary once in a while and think, well, when I get a little bit of time, I'm going to spend some time with this missionary. But your life was so busy, you had no time for the missionary. And so the missionary sat on the chair, day in and day out, month in and month out, and sat there without you giving this missionary any attention. Well, I have found out that that happens in a lot of our fellowships, because this missionary arrives four times a year. And this is our number one missionary, Life in the Sun magazine. And I can't tell you what goes into the preparation of this magazine. And you know, it's not really a real impressive looking magazine. I've seen some real nice, fancy magazines put out by different organizations. They put a lot of money into them, and we really try to be conservative and watch our cost. But the people who write and contribute to this magazine, they take their time waiting before the Lord and searching the scriptures to have something to share to the people around the world and to us. We trust the Father for putting this magazine together. I have to laugh because sometimes there's articles going in there and I fuss with Warren. You know I fuss with Warren once in a while. You do know that, don't you?
Amen.
Keeps him in line. But I fuss with him. I say, well, why are you putting that article in there? You know, because I didn't think it was such a hot article. And of course, you know, he stands his ground too. And so he goes ahead and puts the article in there. Well, it's amazing. We'll get a letter or a phone call saying, oh, that article just really blessed me. You know, so, okay, I was wrong once. And then trusting the Father for finances. As you know, everything in our world goes up, except for your paycheck. More taxes keep coming out of it. But it's just amazing how the Father provides for this missionary. If ever we think we have a source other than the Father, he lets us know that he's still our source. He knows how to dry something up just so that we keep our focus on him, so we know that he is the source of all of our blessings. He supplies all of our needs. Our source is him. I don't care, you know, from what direction it comes. And then this missionary is sent out and travels many miles and goes many directions. Just got a letter from Switzerland this past week. First live contact in Switzerland. Blessed by the magazine. All I can think of is some friend or some relative must have sent this person the magazine, this missionary. What concerns me is, and I'm not pinpointing this at anybody, but I see sometimes we can ignore this missionary. It's not, in talking with people as we travel, I can tell they're not reading the magazine. We get a lot of phone calls on our phone when we're in meetings and our schedule's in here. Where are you? Why aren't you answering my call? Well, we're in Connecticut. But I'd just like to stir your hearts, whoever's listening to me today. This missionary comes. Please don't take him, her for granted, because the Father has just really blessed this magazine. And Teresa has done a beautiful job at upgrading it and making it really look like mm-hmm. like a wonderful publication. She takes a lot of time with it. She's just really, really good at what she does, and she's really upgraded the magazine tremendously. And she does a good job at editing. We have a lot of editors in the fellowship, but they have a way of cutting Warren out of the publications, and we like to keep Warren in there. We like his style and his vernacular to come through, even though we want it correct grammatically and compositionally. But we just want to say a big thank you to Teresa for her labor. Amen. And thank you all for your support and of this missionary. And I just want to encourage you, when you see this little missionary come, just don't set it on a table and walk off and leave this missionary sitting there, because the Father just might have something in here that you might particularly need at that time. and to encourage you, to set you on a chart of a course of study in the scriptures. You just don't know how the Holy Spirit will use this little missionary in your life. And so I just want to encourage you to that. And we just want to thank you all for making the journey with us. Amen.
Just before I bring the word, Paul Friesen is going to sing for us. Go ahead, Paul.
And I love him so. The people ask me how I'd lived till now. I tell them I don't know. The book, I guess they understand how lonely life can be. But life began again the day he took my hand. And yes, I know how lonely life can be. The shadows follow me, and the night won't set me free. But I don't let the evening get me down. Now that he's around me, and he loves me too, his thoughts are just for me. He sets my spirit free. I'm happy that he does. The book of life is brief, and once a page is read, all but love is dead. That is my belief. And yes, I know how lonely life can be. The shadows follow me, and the night won't set me free. But I don't let the evening get me down. Now that he's around me, and I love him so, the people ask me how I'd live till now. I tell them it's Christ in me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, dear.
Now, if you will, I want everybody to take your Bible and turn to Hebrews chapter 4. I'm often describing things like this, that if there are four or five scriptures that are more important than any other, I think I'd have to put this scripture in Hebrews 4 and 12 as one of those most important scriptures. This scripture was not always important to me because there was a time when I preached the whole Bible. I used to brag about that, as I've heard many preachers do, saying, well, we preached the whole Bible. And I've heard people say, well, I went to church and he preached all the way through the Bible. Well, I'm here to tell you today that there's a lot of wasted time in somebody that preaches the whole Bible. Not that it isn't God's Word, not that there isn't something good there to help the people, but because not the whole Bible applies to born-again believers, and not because the whole Bible does not apply to Gentiles, it is important that we rightly divide the Word of truth, and divided truth is very difficult to find in our world today. Hebrews 4 and 12 simply reads, "For the Word of God," and that's the whole book, that's the whole Bible, that's all of the scriptures, "for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." My interest in this is dividing soul and spirit. The whole scriptures must be conscientiously divided by a believer that's going on in the Lord. You've got to understand that there are many things in the Bible. In fact, 4/5 of your Bible is written to people who are soulish. By that, I mean, in the tripartite man of body, soul, and spirit, 4/5 of your Bible is written more directly to those that are soulish. They're trying to improve the soul. And it is for this reason that I think Paul gives us this verse of Scripture in Hebrews, that the Word of God, when properly studied, will help you to divide the difference between that which is written to the soul and that which is written to the spirit. How do you come to that end? Somebody comes along with a message on that, like I may, or you buy somebody's book that shows you how to rightly divide the scriptures. That's not what Paul says. He says if you want to know the difference between the soulish message and the message that belongs to spirit, the Word of God is the difference. The Word of God is a sword. It will divide the two. It will plainly and clearly define what is soul and what is spirit. Now the tripartite man is made up of spirit, soul, and body. And in God's plan, He has dealt with all three of these parts in an unbelievable way. For instance, you take body. You can go to any church, anywhere in this part of the country, and you'll find a message directed toward bodies. Be healed. Be prosperous. We've got the answer. We've got the faith. We've got the power. We've got the gift. And so body has been well taken care of in our generation. More people preach a body message than any other. And I'll always remember Norman Grubb making the statement when he first came into the understanding of our union with Christ. He said, "We're no longer body people." So he got that fixed. He rightly divided the body away, because it isn't the body that determines who you are. It isn't health that determines who you are. It isn't a healing miracle that determines who you are. So body is not our leader in any way. In fact, that was one of the things that caused me to begin to seek God back in the late 50s, when I was hungry to know God in a greater way. I was in big meetings at that time. Thousands of people were coming to the meetings. I had a big tent that seated 3,000 people. And wherever we went, we saw crowds, because the message was healing. The message was getting something from God. The message was getting ahead in your life. And it bothered me. Finally, it began to bother me, because I could see that it wasn't spirit necessarily drawing these people. It was their bodies. It was their own needs that were drawing them to what it was we had to say. And I decided one day that these people's lives are not being changed. And I didn't know what I meant by that, because I figured anybody that got a miracle from God had a changed life. I figured anybody that got healed would be changed. But that's what I was seeing. They weren't changed. They would get a healing, but they weren't changed. They'd get a miracle, but it wouldn't change them. And so I finally, with the help of the Holy Spirit, figured it all out. That people that got a healing, all they wanted was another healing. And people who got a miracle, they wanted another miracle, because that's the way the gospel was presented to them. So we had a body gospel. Well, I was ready to move on from that. And then you have soul. Soul is where you make the decisions and the choices about how you'll live. Soul. That's where your mind, your will, and your intellect are involved. Soulish part of man. And we've had that gospel from the very beginning. As long as time has gone on, we've had a gospel that applied to the soulish part of man. The soulish part of man has to do with those things that are outward, nothing inward. A best illustration of that is Israel. Israel was a group of people that God set aside to be not his children. They were called the children of Israel, never the children of God. They were not set aside to be God's children, because to be God's child, they had to be birthed, and God never birthed an Israelite. To this day, an Israelite is never birthed by God, because he's an Israelite. If he is rebirthed today, it's because he accepted Jesus as his Savior. And once he does that, he's no longer a Jew or an Israelite. But so much for that. The fact is that if you look at Israel, you'll see that God's blessings on them was always an outer thing. For instance, their very deliverance from Pharaoh's bondage was an outer thing. Nothing happened inside of Israelites. It wasn't that God had swooped down on them and done something inside of them. What he did was open up a door so they, as human beings, could exist. They got away from Pharaoh's bondage. They got up to the Red Sea and God opened it up. He opened it up. And they walked across dry ground, more or less. And when they got across, Pharaoh's army came in chasing them, and God caused the waters to come back, and his army was swallowed up. It's just like God can do anything. My God can heal you. God can provide for you. And God can take care of the devil, which is like Pharaoh's army. But notice, nothing ever happened to an Israelite in his spirit. He had no spirit change. He didn't know what that was, because God had never given that to human beings. And all the way through God's dealing with Israel for 1,700 years up to Jesus of Nazareth, they had one miracle after another. It was soulish. It was all outer. It was God trying to get this people to obey him so that he could drop the unlimited blessings on them like the Messiah would come about. But you know what? They never came to that point. Over in Jeremiah 31, God made a promise to them that one of these days you're going to have a new life, you'll have a new heart, you'll be a whole group of people. And you've heard every preacher preach that to you. He shouldn't have done it. He should have rightly divided the scriptures at that point, because that doesn't apply to us. We don't get a new life, a new heart, or a new anything. What we got is another person. Christ is our life. Christ is our life. He is. That's a whole different gospel, you see. And so Israel never knew anything but the unlimited blessings of God, one miracle after another. Even when the early church began, they had one miracle after another and still had not come to the fact that Christ lives in human beings. So the Apostle Paul, who followed all of this up, 1,700 years of God dealing with Israel, a message that Paul knew well because he was a Judaistic priest, all of that was in Paul's background, and yet he knew when Christ was revealed in him, that was a whole new and different gospel and a different understanding about who God was. It is interesting to note that nowhere in Paul's ministry does he say, if you get enough faith, you'll be somebody. He can't say that, because everything is in Christ. He can't give us a clear healing message like Jesus of Nazareth did, because that's contrary to the fact that Christ now lives in human beings. So he was faced with an issue of dealing with people with a different gospel, a whole new gospel to them, and at the same time explaining how it comes about. One of his important explanations about this gospel is Hebrews 4:12, that the Word of God will separate soul and spirit. In the Old Testament, there was no spirit operation in man. It was all soulish. Why was it soulish? They had to obey. They had to do what God said. If they did what God said, they were blessed by God. If they didn't do what God said, judgment came upon them. That was a simple gospel at that time. It was left up to them. It was Adam and Eve in the garden. If they had just done what God said, if they had just obeyed God, they wouldn't have been put out of the garden, and sin wouldn't have come upon the human race. It was that simple. That was their gospel. That was what they should have done. And all the way through the Old Testament, if people obeyed God and did what God wanted them to do, it was amazing. They would be blessed by God. It was a soulish message. It was a soulish gospel. And so throughout the entire Old Testament, there was no spirit salvation. Neither could there be a spirit salvation. There was no way it could be. And you have to get that in your thinking. You have to get that in your mind. They couldn't have had something different because God had never given them anything differently. But the reason I bring this up is because preachers today preach the Old Testament the same as if it was grace. They preach the words out of the Old Testament and combine them with things Paul said or Luke said or somebody else said and make no distinction between them. But you see, there's a lot of difference between a God that has to deal with people on the basis of the people's choices and whether they're doing right or wrong, and a God who miraculously has placed his own son inside the human being. There's a great difference there, you see. And so, with no soul salvation, in Paul's day, he had to enlighten us to spirit salvation. Because Paul can never lead us back into soulish relationship with God. Our primary relationship with God is of the Spirit. He that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. Well, what does that do to soul when this happens? Paul says this is what must be done. This is it. You have to separate soul and spirit. Keep the two separated. Not in your own thinking, but by the study of the Word of God. Paul knew that in the Scriptures Christ had given him about the final gospel, there was enough in those Scriptures that anybody that could read and understand or could be taught by the Holy Spirit would know the difference between soul and spirit. It's in the Scriptures. It's right there. But if you've never had a spirit salvation, then you're going to have trouble coming to the soulish aspect that is given to us in the Scriptures. Just sum it up like this. 4/5 of your Bible deals with people in soulish salvation. That takes in the book of Daniel, the book of Revelation, takes in most of the Bible. Because there everything is done in an outer sense. There is no spirit salvation where Christ is joined to the spirit of man. So, it was never in God's intention. Once Jesus died on the cross, that soulishly men would be dealt with again. Now this is hard on us because of the way we've been raised. Most of us have been raised in commingled religion, where there was never any distinction or difference made in what God said. We figured if God said it to Israel, he said it to us. The preaching is if God said it to Noah, he says it to us. I ran into that the other day when I read an article of a fellow over, and I believe he's in Kentucky, who's building Noah's Ark. He's building Noah's Ark. He wants 600,000 people to come through a year paying $25 or so, and that's not bad business, you know. Anyhow, he's building Noah's Ark, and his attitude is, "This God told me to do this. This is what I'm going to do." It's soulish. See? It's something he's doing. That's the way it was. God spoke to Noah, and so we take what God said to Noah and we apply it to ourselves. God spoke to Abraham, and whatever God said to Abraham, he says to us. And God spoke to David. We love the Psalms, and we get, I think most people get most of their word from God out of the Psalms, but God spoke to David in the Psalms and we take it to us. Or God speaks to Daniel and we apply it to ourselves. Whatever it is, we have been raised in that sort of ministry. We have been raised where it was all commingled, put together, and there was no distinctive message made to the born again. First place, there was none of them born again. They couldn't have had it. But in the second place, now that we see that and we are born again, we ought not to go back and pick up what God said to them and apply it to ourselves. Even though every scripture comes from God and has some merit of application to it, we need to be careful when we apply anything that is not of the spirit, that which is of the soul. When we apply that which is soulish, we need to earmark it. We need to say that that's what it is. It is helping people to work out their own salvation by what they do. It is not speaking to those who have been gloriously rebirthed by God himself through an incorruptible seed and by virtue of the work of Christ on the cross. Right. Well, soul salvation never gives man what it is he needs. Since it is probably today the major message that is being preached, soul salvation. I picked up three or four preachers this week, radio and television, and every one of them had a soulish message. This is what you need to do to be happy. This is what you need to do to make money. This is what you need to do to get your miracle. This is what you need to do. You need to do. You need to do it. They put all the weight back on you. And the glorious thing that the Lord did at the cross was to take the weight off of you. See, 4/5 of the Bible, the weight of God is upon the human. There's only 1/5 of the scriptures where God lifted that weight. He rebirthed these people. He made them his own offspring, and he caused the cross to take care of every need that they'd ever have.
That's good.
How simple that is.
That's good.
He knew what he was doing. He planned to do this from the beginning. Soul salvation can never do for man what he needs to have done. In other words, you could get every miracle available. You could make millions of dollars by giving to the preacher somewhere. Don't try it with me. You could get ahead in life. You could be blessed. I always have somebody coming and saying, well, if I come along with this thing, well, God bless me, I'm in a real bind right now. I'm going through a hard time. Everything's bad right now. What about that? What do you think God thinks of that? He's taken the most priceless thing he has and put it on the inside of you, and then people come to me and say, well, if I believe this, will I get my miracle? If I do this, will God provide for me? Will he take care of me? As if that's all it was on God's mind. But you see, a commingled gospel gives you that impression.
That's right.
Touches your mind like that. Plays with your mind. Soul salvation will never get your need met, because the need of every human being is to get a new nature in them, a God nature, and get rid of a sin nature.
Yes.
That's not soulish. That has nothing to do with your soul. That's why Paul said when somebody gets saved and Jesus comes to live in them, he doesn't come to live in their soul. Sometimes I wished he had, because I have soul problems along the way. But he depends upon the Christ in me to take care of those. No, sir, when I got saved, he put Christ in my spirit. Christ was joined to my spirit. The real me is spirit. You see, that's what people don't know. They don't understand the sin nature.
Yes.
The sin nature was in your spirit. The sin nature was a part of you that to God was the real you, not the soulish part.
Yes.
That's who you were. That's not what you did. Soul is what you do. Spirit is who you are.
You
have to get that fixed in your mind, you see. That's why Paul says the two need to be separated and divided. So preaching to people to do right, preaching to people to quit their sinning, preaching to people to get a miracle, preaching to people that they've got to get ahead in life by joining this program and you'll be blessed, you'll be somebody. Preaching all that to people will never touch their sin nature. So you know what modern religion says? They says you're saved of everything but your sin nature. You still have it. I was raised a Baptist, I know. Every Baptist believes, every believer still has a sin nature. You know why? They never separated soul and spirit. They never separated soul and spirit. Sure, in my soul, I fail. I fall short. That's where my love affair is. That's where I need to stay in love with the Christ that is the real me.
Yes.
But in my spirit, I don't fail. I don't fall short. I don't sin in my spirit, for Christ is no sinner. You understand the difference? This is what my text is aiming at, that the Word of God will separate soul and spirit for you. Now, soul salvation will never get a birthing. There'll never be a birthing in your soulish part. That's your mind, your will, your emotions. Your soulish part is where you're deceived, because you think your soulish part is who you are.
There you go.
No, that's what you do. That's not who you are. What you do is not who you are to God. Think of how many people you've known that have never accepted Jesus as Savior, but they're good people. In fact, I've often said I know some sinners that are a whole lot better at living life than Christians. What's wrong with a statement like that? It's because that sinner will still go to hell because he's not saved by what he does in his soulish part. He's not saved by what he does outwardly. I was raised in an outward religion. I not only was a Pentecostal, we were holy Pentecostals. I mean, we had the vein of holiness where I went. And everything was outer. Especially for the women. Those ungodly women have bad hair, bad dresses, bad everything. And we actually believed and were taught to believe in our minds that if we get straightened up, if the women dress right, if the men talk right, then they're one of us. They were. We were one of them, but not one of them. Why? Because that was all soulish. Well, you say, don't we need to do some things in our soul? Yes, we do. But it's not something God's going to do for us. It's something we work out in our love affair. And if you don't know Christ lives in you, you're not going to live right soulishly. Because you're going to always have an excuse. But if this gospel ever reaches you, that Christ is your life to God and Christ lives in you, then you're never going to have an excuse before the Lord that I couldn't live it. I couldn't make it go. You see, I tell alcoholics this when I talk to them, that you've got no excuse with the new life in Christ. Now, if you've got a religious life, that's soulish. It's not going to work. A fella come to me not long ago, and he said, I go to church every time, I read my Bible every day, and I do the best I can to live the Christian life. But he said, the least little thing that happens to me, I go back to drinking. He didn't ever, in his statement, put his finger on a spirit relationship with Christ. He thought what he did would save him. And if he didn't do it, he couldn't be saved. He couldn't stop drinking. He couldn't be who he was supposed to be. My heart goes out to him, because most people in Christianity are at that stage because they don't know Christ lives in them. Well, only coming to the final gospel will we ever get straightened out in our thinking. If you want to know where to start with the final gospel, you start with Ephesians 1 and 4, 1 Peter 1 and 23. You get it fixed about what happens to you on God's part, and quit playing around with what happens to you on your part. One of the most sorrowful things I've seen happen in Christianity is the awful load we put on sinners to be saved and to live the life after they're saved. We put a heavy load on them. We turn them to the outer things immediately. Like Israel of old, God could only do outer things for them because he couldn't touch their spirit. It was all outer. And that's what we do to new converts. I can well remember when I had the big tent ministry, we would have personal workers that would deal with people who came forward. And we would always tell them, get in a good church, read your Bible every day, find a place to pray, and pay your tithes and offerings. That was the fourfold gospel. What'd we do? We took them away from what God did the moment they accepted Jesus as their Savior, which was a spirit thing, and reversed them back to soulish living. You know what happens to people like that? Sometimes if they hold steady and they stay in a church or several churches they may have to go through to get to this, but the day will come when something will happen to them in their spirit, and the first thing they'll say is, boy, I feel like I'm saved all over. Amen. You know what? They probably are. They probably are. Because coming to that took the ordeal of getting free of soulish religion. Now, soulish religion is deep. It's deep in people. People in the high churches, Episcopalians, and no reflection, or Catholics, they got a strong move now in America on the original high church. I don't forget what they call it. But it's made up of all of this junk outside. Crosses, steeples, gold candelabras, candles lit, all of this outer stuff. Not that this couldn't touch the heart. Not that this couldn't make people cry. Not that this couldn't make people pray. But it's outer. Nothing has happened in them. A fellow said to me one time, you're looking for people to be supermen. No, I'm looking for them to be Christians. Christ people. That's what I'm interested in. That's why they were first called Christians, because Christ lived in them. He lived in them. The reason why Paul said to separate soul and spirit was that in his day, even though Christ had died on the cross, that was in the message, even though there was a day of Pentecost where they received the power, that was in the message, they still would not allow this business of Christ in them to be known. You see, I believe that the 120 on the day of Pentecost could have known Christ lived in them. Because John 14 and 20 says, on that day you shall know that I'm in you and you're in me. They didn't know it. Just like the Pentecostal world and religious world today doesn't know Christ lives in them. He's there nonetheless, because that's a God thing and not a man thing. But this is why God raised up the Apostle Paul. Paul had to be raised up in order for there to be a clear-cut gospel. He had to get somebody that had come from the very bottom and start them out right to understand what the final gospel was. The gospel where God would get his children to live in his house. Paul lived in a day when he saw the soulish gospel all around him. There were those around Paul who were present on the day of Pentecost with the 120. There were those with Paul who saw the blind man healed at the gate and thousands saved. People who were in churches that grew and multiplied every day, early church. Paul was with them. But he never heard a word about Christ living in them. Nothing written. So when Paul received his revelation of Christ in him and began to preach it, who turned against him first? Those very people. Those very people who were akin to Jesus of Nazareth, whose message Jesus of Nazareth message was a soulish message, because it hinged on what you do. You want to get along with your fellow man, forgive him. Do something, and then you can get along. This was his message because it came under Moses' law. So do you understand now why he said you need to separate soul and spirit? Because there's a multitude of people who do right in their soulish part. They do everything just right outwardly, but not from the basis that it is another in them that is their life.
Yes.
They haven't come to that. I wish I could be sweet and just nod my head once in a while. That's the direction you ought to go. But I can't do that. I've got to join Paul in making boldness the way this message comes out. Yes. We're going to have to be bold to deliver it. Because people think, well, he's talking about what my preacher always says.
Uh-huh.
You ever had that?
Oh.
My preachers always preach that. I'm not saying that he doesn't. I don't know what he preaches, but I'm telling you, you need to know the difference in your thinking and in your mind between what you do and what God has done in you. Then when you get a hold of what God has done in you marvelously, you're going to straighten up your soulish part. You're going to do that out of love. That's where your love affair is. But until you know that your life is not your own, you can't straighten up yourself. Until you know that Christ in you is your hope of glory, you're not going to be able to anchor everything you do to that one factor, that it really doesn't matter. I'm glad to hear some of you, when you talk, say it just don't matter. I got troubles that just don't matter. You're getting a hold of it. But if you think you can stand on that all by yourself, you're mistaken. It don't matter because Christ is in you. It don't matter because your new life is already fixed eternally. You've got to apply that in your thinking to what is truth, what is the real truth. You need to understand that in your soulish part, you'll never be free of this love affair, of your need to bring yourself under subjection to this Christ that is within you. Just as Paul said he brought his body under, you bring your soul under subjection to the Christ that is within you. What you think, what you do, where you go, the way you act are all ideas that have to do with your soulish living. In the Christ life, we have never bore down so much on what you do or what you don't do, for the simple reason that if you don't love the Christ that is in you, then it don't really matter what you do. It's a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal, they say. It doesn't really matter what you do if you don't know Christ is your life. Because if you're trying to dress yourself up and make yourself look righteous and religious, I don't know who will accept it. I guess somebody in a church building may. But it's not acceptable to God. Because Christ lives in you. You need to get a hold of that in your thinking. The thing that will help you most with your spirit living, and I need to make this clear possible. Before the Christ life, I always thought spirit living was somebody that was always full of the Spirit, jumping up and down. Jerking, we used to have the jerks. You ever seen anybody with the jerks? I've seen a lot of jerks, but these people had it. People who did things and they call, oh, I'm in the Spirit. Or preachers would say, I'm really anointed. You know how soulish that statement is. We can go into that sometimes. That's a very soulish statement. They're handling the words of life. I don't know how much they have to be stirred to get it out. But our audiences are like that. They like to be stirred. They like to have somebody that's really working on it. Well, when we talk about spirit living, we're talking about something that happened at the cross. We're not talking about something you need. Being full of the Holy Ghost is going to help you soulishly, because that's where the Holy Spirit works, is in your soulish part, teaching you, training you. But to be a spirit believer, your life is not anchored to how you feel soulishly. Your life is anchored to the cross. Spirit living comes out of the cross. Those that have spirit salvation know what happened to them at the cross. This is one of the most powerful things that ever happened to me, because when I was in the midst of those big meetings, the Holy Spirit put me in 1958 to study in Paul's epistles. You'd think in all this time I would have learned something. I'm still learning, so don't credit me or even criticize me. I got a lot to learn. The Holy Spirit put me to Paul's epistles. And as I began to read them, the Holy Spirit began to work in my life as I'd never before. And words that were written in Paul's epistles began to speak out to me. And when I finished reading them through the first time, I came to two conclusions, and only one of them will I talk about. I came to the conclusion that something happened to me at the cross that I have never known about. You see, I was a so-called spirit-filled preacher. I was helping people be healed, talk in tongues, and do all of these marvelous things. But when I finished reading Paul's epistles for the first time, it came to me by the Spirit that something happened to me at the cross that I don't know anything about. Of course, later on I was to find out that nowhere else in the Scripture is the message of the cross taught, only in Paul's epistles. So I'd have been a bigger dumbbell than I was not to catch that. At least six times he gives the prominent verses in the Bible that deals with Paul's, with Christ's death on the cross. And that isn't dealt with anywhere else in the Scriptures like that. But I came to that conclusion that something happened to me at the cross. Well, I'd always preached that's where he did something for me.
Yeah, that's right.
He did something for you, dear friends. Accept Jesus as your Savior and he'll do it for you right here, right now. That was my message. But you know what? I found out he did something to me at the cross that I didn't know anything about. And as that grew in my understanding, I realized the hundreds and thousands of people that I had led to God and had never preached the true gospel to them. They come to God. That's where I learned what grace was. I look back on it now and I say, dear God, I knew so little about your plan and what you were doing. It's a marvel that you saved some of these people. And every once in a while, somebody gets a hold of me that was saved in one of those early meetings. Yes, sir. They say, I got saved then. I had a lady just not long ago from Arkansas called me on the telephone and said, I just heard you were still alive. And I wanted to tell you that I got saved in one of your meetings. Well, I said, that was the grace of God. Praise God. See, I didn't know the gospel. I didn't know any different. I didn't know what God had done and was doing in my own life. I couldn't figure it out at all. But the epistles opened up to me and showed me what happened to me at the cross. Now my soulish part wanted to understand that. All of a sudden I realized that spiritually something had taken place. And then it was that I went back into Paul's epistles and went through them again, and for the first time, a verse like Galatians 2:20 caught me. There it is. Didn't say Christ crucified. Didn't say Paul crucified. It said, I am me. I am crucified with Christ. That's what started it. Something did happen to me there. I was killed. Why didn't somebody tell me that? Why have I been wrestling with my sins and shortcomings and failures all these years and trying to tell other people just get full of the Holy Ghost and you won't have any more trouble, when all of the time I was crucified at the cross? I thought there was a me that was impossible. I was impossible. I couldn't overcome my... I was like an alcoholic. I was like a person that was obsessed with something. I figured that's the way it was. I figured that's the way I was. I was born like that. That's the way I was. I had no concept that anything happened to me at the cross. I was crucified there. I was killed out, made possible to enter God's plan. I was killed out there. No longer could I do something that was offensive to God from my spirit, because I had a new life there. Crucified with him. And then I was to find out I died with him. That when he died, I died. I was to find out when he was buried, I was buried. When he rose from the grave, I spiritually came out of the grave and have a spiritual life, not a life anymore where I'm still wrestling in my soulish part trying to put it all together. You understand what spirit life is? You don't have to put it together anymore. It's always in our soulish life and our soulish preaching that we're trying to get you to put it together. You don't pray enough. You don't give enough money. You're not winning enough souls. You're not out working for God. We're trying to get you to put together what you already got together perfect. What we need you to do is so fall in love with him that that love affair will overflow in your life, that wherever you go, things will work out for you. Things will happen to you. We're trying to get you to the place where it is not you who lives any longer, it's Christ that lives. And I run into people daily that ought to know better who say, oh, I'm having such a hard time. I'm going through such a bad place. I hurt so bad. Dear friends, you no longer live. Get it fixed in your mind. Start thinking like that. You say, well, I still hurt, probably. But you're closer to the answer. You're closer to the answer when you give up to he that is your life. You're closer to it. Paul would say, finally, it don't matter whether you live or die. Get it fixed. You're a new creation. You're a whole new individual. That starts at the cross. It's at the cross where you begin to see yourself as God sees you. If Jesus, who committed no sin, at the cross suffers and hurts as he did, then we need to see ourselves in the same light. Turn with me to Romans Chapter 13. Turn to chapter 13 in Romans to verse 14. This is a good verse of Scripture. I'd like to explain what I think about it. 14th verse says, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. What is he doing? First thing he does here is separate soul and spirit. Where do you have the lust? In spirit? No. You have the lust in the flesh. Lust of the flesh. things you want. That's the big wanter in you. Oh, if God would just do this for me. If God just make a way here. He's already put his son in you. Christ already lives in you. When will there be a love affair with him that lives in you so that he's bigger than your problem? That was God's intention when he gave this message to Paul. Now you see what I do with that statement? I cut out all the rest of the scriptures that you've got in your mind about how you need to get a hold of God. That isn't the way it works in Christianity. In Christianity, you fall in love with this Christ that's in you. You begin to see him as your life. I don't think people believe that. When you start to see him as your life, your words are going to change. Your mind is going to change. I spent a lot of time trying to get people to renew their mind, and I always put the problem back on them, get your mind straightened out. The fact is, if they just loved that Christ that was in them more than they loved themselves, if they put on Christ. Now, I'm sure Paul was talking about a little electronic button that if you punch that button, Christ comes up. You get it? Put on Christ. And you won't be giving in to the soul all the time. Your spirit never hurts beyond Christ bearing the load. I often thought about that verse where he said, they put no more on you than you're able to bear. That's because you put on Christ. You got a big problem coming up, put on Christ. Don't turn to how you're going to answer it. Don't turn to how much you hurt. And don't turn to Sister Susie to fast and pray for you. Put on Christ. See? Then after you've done everything you know to do and it begins to work, then you can say, Susie, thank you for praying. She shouldn't have been asked to do that anyhow. You see, we're not a one-bodied people to where we see and think alike. This fellow that's starting these home churches said, we may not have the theology that we've always had. That doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. What matters is Christ. Not what you think about God and how to do things godly. What matters is the Christ that is in you already, who was there the moment you accepted Jesus as your Savior, who is the gift from God that makes you a Christ person, a Christian. He's already there. So you put him on. And don't even make provision for the flesh. The flesh will be the life of the soul if you're not careful. You know what's happened to America? The love affair with God is being bled from us right now by ungodly people who want us all to be fleshites and live like they live. They'll never do it. They may kill out the last Christian, true Christian, but until they do, Christians are going to live the life that is in them, Christ. Because that's what a Christian is. So we put on Christ. Go to Romans 6. Have you been in Romans 6 lately? Some of you, dear hearts, need to read Romans 6 once a month. Some of you could probably get along with it every 2 weeks. None of you can get along with it a month without it. You need to spend time in Romans 6. I just want to pick out the 11th verse because I could take hours here talking about Romans 6. He said, but reckon yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin. Have you ever looked at that verse through the Spirit that's in you? What does that say? That verse says you're dead to sin right now. Where? In your spirit part. If you knew you were dead to sin, then why would you continue sinning? Dead people don't sin. But of course, soulishly, you can get all twisted up in your mind about who you are. You're dead to sin. John says you're still going to sin, and that's so. But you're dead to it. You're still going to commit some sins, but you're dead to it. What's dead to it? Your spirit part. Your spirit salvation. Christ in you made you dead to sin. Don't you see now why Paul said to separate soul and spirit? Because God's not looking at you soulishly. He's not looking at you so much as what you do as to who you are. That's the way he looks at you. He sees you by Christ in you. What your trouble is, you don't see yourself as Christ sees you. And you know why? We preachers are to blame. We've let our people go without the true gospel. We let our people go without following Paul as he follows Christ. We let our people get a hold of Bibles that have ruled out everything that has to do with spirit salvation that they possibly could. Yeah. We've done that to you. And it's time we stopped. Even the co-minglers that have some good and some bad don't have the answer until they see Christ as all in all. That's the answer. Reckon. See what he says? Reckon yourselves to be dead. Reckon. Draw a circle around it and write the word soul next to it. Where do you reckon? In your soulish part. This book says to your soul, soul, this person is dead. Quit messing around with them. Quit misleading them. They're dead to sin. Then why would they continue sinning? We're not perfect in this regard in our soul. Our mind is not perfect. But as our love affair grows, we cease from our works of unrighteousness and move into who we are. That's a progress, a process, a growth. That's the way it works. It's at the cross you became dead to sin. Interesting thing here, since I've been on this subject so much today, the kingdom message is always concerned with sin. Have you noticed? The preacher is always preaching against somebody's sin, somebody's shortcoming, something somebody did. Why? Why is he doing that? He's doing that because in soulish salvation, you become aware of everybody's sin because of your sin. That's the way it goes. We watch a preacher who preaches heavy against sin. He may have it on his mind. Believers don't concentrate on sin because sin has already been put under at the cross. The devil has already been put under for believers at the cross. And since he said in Romans 6 and 11 that we are dead to sin, we ought to live as such. The kingdom message puts people under sin. You know why? Because it lays the burden back on them to do right. And so the gospel is not that you're dead to sin. It is now when you've done wrong, get right with God. Get in this altar. Pray through. And if you fail God, make up for it. I always hated to hear those words. And I wondered why I didn't like them, even when I said them. I used to tell people to fail God, what you need to do is get in here and make it right. Get right. Make it right. When the sin was already covered at the cross, they making it right meant nothing. Heard a fellow this past week preaching, and his subject was forgiveness, how Christians needed to forgive. That's true. You feel led, you ought to forgive. But it is already forgiven. Amen. It's already taken care of. Why do they want us to do it? Because that's the machination. That's the religious machine. We'll get something better out of them if they do this. We'll get what we wasn't getting before. As I told you before, when I saw an old boy backsliding in the congregation and he come into a service, I knew he was coming back to God. But I also knew he was good to do something he hadn't done before. And I'd have a big offering at that time and get something out of him. Because he's making it right. That was my ignorance, not a wrong. But I always saw that people wanted to do that. They wanted to make it right because they didn't know Christ was in them. They'd been denied the truth of who they were. That's why the kingdom message deals with sin. Another thing, the kingdom message never deals with the cross. I think the number one thing people have asked me through the years about a certain very popular preacher, whoever he was why doesn't he say something about the cross? Because the cross is an antithesis to human work. If the cross is properly preached, there's nothing you or anybody else can do to finish it. See, that's why they don't preach the cross. They like to preach by his stripes we're healed. But they don't preach the cross as a place where Jesus says, it is finished, no more humanity can possibly do. Amen. Lastly, at the cross, we were set free from the law. Now, I've given these verses many times. Go to Galatians 4, mark it again. And I'm going to paraphrase these verses as I read them because they're wholly important to you. He's using the subject here of Abraham. In verse 28, he says, now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. What is the flesh? What was the most outer thing in the Bible, and especially in Abraham's time? It was the law. It was doing what God said to do to be somebody. As he persecuted him that was born after the flesh, even so now. Nevertheless, what says the Scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son. Cast out the law. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. What's the issue here? It's the law. It's obeying God's law to be blessed. So we cast out what it is to be who we are. We are a free people who have been delivered and set free at the cross of Jesus Christ. The cross takes care of every inner thing. Every inner thing inside of you, in you who the real you is, the cross takes care of everything there. The outer things are in your soulish part. If you're not careful, nothing of you, really you, ever comes out. Because all of the outer things are promoted by the soul. That's why Paul said, separate the two. Because before God, you stand perfect in spirit. But also the scripture says that anything that keeps you from being this free person, you need to get rid of it. The law is abolished at the cross. That's the end of it. Don't mess around with it. Don't say a little bit of law is necessary. Don't say, well, if we didn't have law, how would people live? Parents come to me and say, well, how am I going to teach my child if I don't teach them law? You teach them to obey you. That's the law to them. You don't teach them Moses' law. Amen. Teach them that they ought to obey you and do what you say. And don't mix the two up. The reason why is you are their guardian. You are their steward. God has made you the steward of those children, and you need to do what is right toward them at any cost. You'll answer to God for how you take care of children. Amen. But that's not Moses' law. That's not even a law that'll be kept indefinitely, because when they get older, that law that is fixed in them will cause them to do what is right. It'll pass. In the meantime, don't confuse the two. When you do what is right, what you know to be right, that's not keeping Moses' law. That's obeying the Lord who is your life. There are commandments you need to keep. The commandments are not the Ten Commandments. I've told you about 377 of them that I've marked in Paul's epistles all the way through, except the book of Hebrews. 377 different commands given to us by Paul. They are not like Moses' law that had judgment attached to it. They are love commands. If you love him, this is what you'll do. Children need to be taught that your word is what they need to do, because you love them and they love you. Don't ever separate love from it. That's just one little verse that's important in a Christ's life. The scriptures will rightly divide the soul and the spirit. Let it be so. Well, that's enough said by me. And I tell you, you're about the best group I've ever talked to. You who are listening to me there, you're the best group I ever talked to. God love every one of you, and make your journey better than it's ever been before. Trust him, he'll do it. Reach over and take your neighbor by the hand. It's that time right now. Reach over and take your neighbor by the hand. And I like to tell you this, to look over and look your neighbor in the eye there. That may be your husband or wife. Look at them and tell them sincerely in this little song, I see Jesus in you. You're dealing with your children. Look at them every once in a while and say, I see Jesus in you. If they ever accepted Jesus, you could do that. So let it happen, will you? Sing it with me now. I see Jesus in you. I see Jesus in you. In your life and all that you do. I see Jesus in you, because I see Jesus in me. I see Jesus in me, in my life and all that I do. I see Jesus in me. That's it. Hug everybody you can before they get out of here. God love you.